Well, good morning. Welcome to church. Hey, it's so great to be in God's house. Let's stand and we're going to sing praises to Jesus this morning. Join me in the song. We sing. Praise be within our silence. Church, who here in the room can testify that the Lord has been good in their lives? Yeah? God is so good and He cares so much about each one of us. You know, we're reminded in the book of Nahum, chapter 1, verse 7, it says, "The Lord is good, a refuge in times of trouble, and He cares for those who trust in Him." One of the ways that God speaks to us is through His word, regardless of where we are in life. If we're in a season of blessing and goodness, His word reminds us of His goodness. If you're in a season of fear, doubt, hurt, His word can speak life and encouragement to you. So we want to move into a time where we're encouraged by Scripture. We're going to open both sides of the stage up for you. If you have a verse that speaks to the Lord's goodness, one or two verses, if you just want to make your way during this next song to either side of the stage, and we're going to read those Scriptures aloud and encourage us.
Yeah.
God's word.
2 Corinthians 4, 16 and 17. Therefore, we do not lose heart, but though our outward man is decaying, for our inner man is being renewed day by day. For momentarily, light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory, far beyond all comparison.
Psalm 86:15. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness.
Hebrews 4:15 and 16. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore draw near with confidence to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and may find grace to help in time of need.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, the joys of those who take refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you godly people, for those who fear him will have all they need. Even strong young lions sometimes go hungry, but those who trust in the Lord will lack no good thing. Psalm 34:8-10.
Micah 7:19. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea.
Habakkuk 3:17-19. Though the tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God the Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like a deer's. He makes me tread on my high places.
Deuteronomy 7:9. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God. He is faithful. He is the faithful God, keeping his covenant of love to 1,000 generations of those who love him and keep his commands.
Psalm 31:19. Oh, how abundant is your goodness, which you have stored up for those who fear you and worked for those who take refuge in you. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Psalm 33:20-22. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield, for our heart is glad in him, because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you.
Psalm 116, the Lord is gracious and righteous. Our God is full of compassion. The Lord protects the simple-hearted. When I was in great need, he saved me. Be at rest once more, O my soul, for the Lord has been good to you. For you, O Lord, have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling, that I may walk before the Lord in the land of the living.
I got Exodus 14:14. It says, the Lord will fight your battles. You need only to be still.
Psalms 39:4-18. Lord, remind me how brief my time on earth will be. Remind me that my days are numbered, how fleeting my life is. The days of the upright are numbered by the Lord, and their heritage will be forever.
Reaches to you and me. Set aside this time because that's exactly what we need today, to behold you, to see you, to hear from you, to understand that you are God and we are not. And in that, Lord, we adore you and we give our best focus and attentive praise. There's no point to gather unless you would lead us, Lord. There's no point to come unless you would be here. And so we behold you today. We honor you. We worship you. Receive our praise today in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. All right, well, why don't you go ahead and take a seat. Morning, everybody. How's it going? Good to see you. Way to lean into worship today. It's an awesome thing to be able to be together this first part of the week. I want to first welcome anybody who's maybe here for the first time or here somewhat recently. I met somebody from Kansas City today, so good luck. But really great, whatever your story is, we're glad you're here. But if you've not met someone yet here, we'd love that. We'd love to get a chance to meet you. There's a welcome area in the lobby, and I'm going to hang out there right after church. So glad you're here. For everybody, we want to encourage you to use the Connect card. It's digital, and it's on the app. So how many of you have the Church Center app, the new app in the last 4 or 5 weeks? Anybody? Man, I would encourage you to get it. It's really helpful. There's a lot of great stuff on there. But one of the things you can do is when you come for a worship gathering, to just let us know you're here. With that, you can also submit a prayer request or a praise. This is what the Lord's doing. Please pray for me. And our staff prays through all those every week. So please do that today and each time you come for worship. 2024 is the 20th anniversary of Harvest Christian Academy. Some of you remember when that started. Some of you are like, what is Harvest Christian Academy? It is a school, preschool through high school, that's on our Elgin campus. And we're just praising the Lord for 20 years. So we got a little video to watch. Let's watch it together.
In August of 2003, our leaders felt like the Lord had asked us to raise $20 million for four things, one of which was to launch Harvest Christian Academy. It was really an idea. It was going to be one of the greatest discipleship ministries of our church to disciple the next generation for Christ.
I remember sitting in a church service where it was said, okay, we are going to start taking applications for teaching. And so I applied, and I was the first hire, according to the principal. She said, congratulations, you are the first hire of Harvest Christian Academy.
I remember walking around and Julie Giardino saying, well, here's going to be classrooms, and this is going to be this, and this is going to be this, and it was all just green carpet everywhere. And then we're all looking for teachers, and people kept coming along on the team.
I had to wear a hard hat at my interview as they took me around the campus, and they were still saying things 2 weeks before school, like, here's where the cafeteria is going to be. And I kept looking out over a sea of cubicles thinking, I don't know how this is going to be a school in 2 weeks.
We literally had to rely on the Lord for every next step. I can't tell you how we just prayed for enrollment, just for kids to show up and for families to come.
We decided to get on board and send our daughter to an idea that was being created here. We were able to walk through these hallways, and there was stud walls up in a few places, and the vision was here. We got on board to that vision and decided this is where she's gonna be.
The first year of school, it was a startup for a school. It was small. We were down in I don't think we're even legally allowed to call it a gym. It was the activity space downstairs. We had every classroom that met there, and there was one class on half the gym and the other class on the other half of the gym.
I just remember loving it. It was always a youth group and Awana, and so that felt very similar to me, and I'd never had that in a school setting. I remember having my Bible was like part of the school supplies. That was so new to me. We just did so many things that you don't do in a public school.
I started in kindergarten, and I just went all the way through senior year of high school. As a result of that, you kind of just felt this strong community. Everybody knew each other. You'd see each other outside of school, and it didn't feel weird because you felt like you were a part of it. My most fun memories were camaraderie with my teammates on the cross country team and at the track team. It's hard to say where I wasn't benefited, where I wasn't growing, where I wasn't, you know, improving in some way, whether it's academically, in my faith, or in my personal skills with others.
Just really fun to like think back on all the memories I made, being like our friendships as like we kind of grew up. I think that's what made it really special.
We've done alumni surveys, and the biggest common theme that we've seen is, what did you love most about HCA? Was my friendships, my teachers.
Coaching is my platform. Coaching is a platform for discipleship and building relationships with kids. We do want to be great athletes, and we want to put together great teams. But that is nothing if we're not great followers of Christ.
I would say HCA is a family. We get to see the kids inside of the classroom for 50 minutes, but we get to see them outside of school in athletics. We get to see them at church on the weekends. It's a community of people that are like-minded to advance the gospel of Christ.
They had some difficulties as a family. We lost their dad to cancer, and the school family just really surrounded us and helped us, helped me support the kids in that difficult time.
I'm glad we were part of that growing process with the school. I mean, we had challenges to walk through, but yet it's what made the process, I think, really rewarding.
Every time things seem
hard or rough, it's like, okay, here's what the Lord did again, and just time and time again, to see what he has brought the school through. Little bumps, big bumps, but just his faithfulness in the school has totally grown.
I've seen so much progress and growth and amazing things in the programs. Two of our kids have graduated from HCA, and it's been great to be able to kind of send them off and move them on to their next stages with such a solid foundation.
After seeing what the school has done through our kids, I would love to see more kids being able to go through the same thing. The impact that it has on them is unreal.
To see where it is now, yeah, from 20 years ago when it started, it's amazing. And we are so thankful for the school and amazing to see what God has done.
We have a very strong foundation, the biblical worldview, a strong academic program. And those two blending together and partnering with our parents, we have a great opportunity to make our school whatever we want it to be.
For the next 20 years of Harvest, it's just exciting to see how it's gonna grow.
I don't know what the Lord has for us, but I've already seen how he's grown the school and how he's expanded our high school. I'm excited to see more people come and experience what we have at HCA.
Equipping the next generation is one of the most important things that we can do. And that's one of the best things about Harvest is, no matter all the stuff that's gone on throughout the years, the ups and downs, right? It's always back to the mission of seeing students being trained up as followers, as disciples.
Lives have been changed because of being on staff or sending their children or being part of the community here. Who knows what the Lord has in store for the next 20 years.
Yeah, praise the Lord for that. You know, the mission of the church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ, and the mission of the school is to do the same thing in an educational setting. So if that is of any interest to you or somebody you know, you can go check out their website, harvestchristianacademy.org, if you want to learn more. Hey, we're going to pray in just a moment for our church. We also want to pray for another local church, as we do. This week is Heritage Church in Barrington and Pastor Kip Bloom. Now, Kip is familiar to Harvest because he kind of grew up in and through the church. So we're always praying and cheering for them and excited to see what the Lord's doing. So we'll pray for them in a moment. They asked that we would pray for their outreach efforts this spring and summer, and also a permanent church home in the village of Barrington. So let's pray with them about that, all right? We're going to worship through our giving, and to do that, let's focus our attention on God's word. 2 Corinthians 9:7 says this: each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, I like that a lot, because it isn't just, hey, check the box, hey, you better get involved, you better do this. It's a heart thing, and God loves to see a cheerful giver. So if you don't feel that cheerfully, I'd say hang on to it. But if you have an overflow of your heart to the Lord, then we should give. And the ways we do that are here on the screen. And this meets the needs of the church and keeps the ministry reaching out in the name of Jesus Christ. So this is our opportunity. We're going to commit that to the Lord. Let's all pray together. Heavenly Father, we love you and we need you. And we are so thankful that we can come and be reminded this morning of who you are. And Lord, we pray that you would bless and lead Heritage Church and Pastor Kip and the whole team there, Lord. Would you help them to be faithful to your word and proclaiming Jesus Christ inside and outside the church? Help them with these outreach efforts, Lord. And as they look for another facility, would you provide, Lord, at just the right way at the right time? Lord, in our church, we trust you and we need you. And we are asking you to do the work only you can do in our church. So thank you, Lord, for what you've done in Harvest Christian Academy. Your hands are all over that. And we pray that there be more young men and women raised up to follow Jesus Christ through those efforts. Lord, now we're going to lean into your word, and we pray that you would just use it. Help it to meet us right where we're at, that we could hear from you and respond to you today. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, well, before we get into the message today, we're going to take just a moment and stand up and try to be friendly, all right? So just say hi to somebody around you before the message. We'll be right back.
Hey, it's good to see you. I'm going to jump right into it. If you have a Bible with you, I want to invite you to open it to Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verses 1 to 4. It's four verses today. The book of Ecclesiastes is one of the most surprising books of the Bible. We've been doing a series on it over the last little while. We're kind of only a few weeks left in it, but we're at the part now where we kind of want to show you some of the more upside down ways that the preacher, the guy who's actually speaking in Ecclesiastes, we call him Kohelet, which is the Hebrew word for preacher, what he's trying to, the way that he views the world and how different it is. So let me begin by telling you totally ahead of time that this sermon is going to be filled with 1990s references to many different things. If you don't like that, I'm sorry. It's just the way it is. And let's kick it off with a video that immediately came to mind when I read the first line of this. It's from one of the great shows in the history of shows, Seinfeld. So, George Costanza.
Oh, I feel great for 85.
You know, the average lifespan for an American male is like 72. You're really kind of pushing the envelope there.
I'm not afraid of dying. I never think about it.
You don't? Boy, I think about it a lot. I think about it at my age. Imagine how much I'll be thinking about it at your age. All I'll do is just keep thinking about it till it drives me insane.
I'm grateful for every moment I have.
Grateful? How can you be grateful when you're so close to the end? When you know that any second, poof, bam, oh, it could all be over. I mean, you're not stupid. You can read the handwriting on the wall. It's a matter of simple arithmetic, for God's sake.
I guess I just don't care.
What are you talking about? How can you sit there and look me in the eye and tell me that you're not worried? Don't you have any sense? Don't you have a brain? Are you so completely senile you don't even know what you're talking about anymore?
So the reason it's funny, of course, is because nobody sits across a table from an elderly person and talks about how death is on the doorstep. And nobody would encourage that person to think, you know, the best thing for you is to consider how close you are to death. In our culture, we try our very best to avoid talk about death. We have lots of special words for it, right? He passed away. He is up there. Whatever. We have all sorts of special language that we use for death. And what's really surprising is that in the book of Ecclesiastes, when you start looking up what how we ought to view death, one of the things that Kohelet says is, oh, you should think about it a lot. I mean, he basically plays the George Costanza here. And when you read what he has to say, you're a little bit put off by it. You're not sure what to do, especially as a Christian, right? We Christians are like, wait a minute. We have stuff about death in the Bible that helps us think through these things. In fact, one of the best passages in the entire Bible is 1 Corinthians 15:54. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Every Easter, we proclaim this. We say, because Jesus rose from the dead, death no longer owns us. It doesn't actually have a sting in the tail for us. And because that's the case, Christians are in a really unique moment. You have a really unique opportunity because if death no longer has a sting and it doesn't pose the threat, maybe it could become a really good companion. I mean, like if you had a tiger and you decided that you were going to declaw and defang the tiger, I imagine that the tiger would be a lovely pussycat. Like, I would imagine it'd be great to have a tiger around the house. I mean, just to scare off the Amazon guy at the very least, but he'd probably be a great companion to walk around the street with and stuff. You know, of course, that he doesn't pose a threat. Everybody else thinks he poses a massive threat, but you're like, nah, he doesn't pose a threat. He's lost his sting. So death, for the Christian, perhaps, could be helpful to think about. Well, that's pretty much what Kohelet's going to try to argue here in the next few minutes. And in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verses 1 to 4. So let's think about death, folks. You're glad you came to church. You will be. Let's think about death. Two steps to this. Number one, I'm going to try to argue the importance of thinking about death, which is largely what this text is trying to emphasize. And second, what are the outcomes of thinking about death? So then we're going to try ourselves to think, all right, so if we accept the premise that we should think about death more, what will happen in our lives when we start thinking about it more? How will it reframe the way we think and live to consider the fact that every single person in the room, like Thelma and Louise, right, 90s, is headed toward a cliff? Death is undefeated. Well, except for one. So let's talk about death. The importance of thinking about it and then the outcomes of thinking about it. Here's the first bit of that. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 1. A good name is better than precious ointment. This is basically perfume, but really expensive perfume, like really nice. I don't know, Coco Chanel. That's the only one I know. So I'm assuming it's expensive and it smells nice. My mom had it once and she cried when she got it for Christmas. So I imagine that it's a lovely, lovely scent. A good name is better, though, than precious ointment. In what way? I mean, a good name, he's talking about your reputation. A good name is better than precious ointment. Have you ever walked behind someone, appealing to mostly the men in the room, have you ever walked behind somebody whose perfume is just beautiful, right? You don't know the person, you don't know the woman at all, she's walking in front of you. And the perfume is just beautiful. Perfume is interesting in that it is meant to allure. It is meant to advertise that this person who's wearing it is actually a beautiful person. The kind of person you'd want to be around, because if you smell that good, maybe your insides, meaning your character and all those things, maybe there is good. The challenge, of course, with perfume is that it's a little surfacey, right? It's a little surfacey. The difference between perfume and a good name is that the good name is actually what the smell of the inward character is giving off. So whereas perfume is advertising something in terms of possibility, right, this person could possibly be beautiful, they're advertising beauty, a good name is actually fulfilled possibility, right? Well, that's what he's trying to get here. A good name is better than precious ointment, and he's going to compare it to the day of death and the day of birth. He's trying to say, look, the day of your death is better than your day of your birth, which is a shocking statement. What are you talking about? The day of my death is better than the day of my birth. Well, in what way? Well, similarly, this is called a parallel. In Hebrew poetry, you call these a parallelism, meaning the first two lines here are saying the same thing as the second lines. And so you got to figure out, in what way is the day of death the same as precious ointment, the same as a good name, and in which way is the day of birth the same as precious ointment? Well, look, in the day of your birth, there's a lot of promise, yeah? We love to think about the promise. The little baby you're holding in your arms, and you're looking at him, and you start thinking about all the things that this baby could end up doing one day. One of the best poems or pieces of writing I've read in the last, several years, actually came from the pen of a soccer fan who supports the same soccer team that I do. He's in England, and he had a baby boy. And he's decided to write this ode, basically, to his newborn son. And so here's what he wrote. Doesn't know his baby much at all. He just held him in his arms. One day, I'll take you to the football. That's the real football, the one where you play with your feet. For those of you okay? Because the foot? Okay. One day I'll take you to the football. You'll be cold and ask me which team we are. I'll buy a program for you, but it'll be me that keeps it in a drawer forever. One day you'll laugh at nothing and it'll be better than any joke I've ever told. One day we'll build a fort. One day we'll go to Disney and you can meet the real Mickey. One day you'll cry so much I think you're broken. One day I'll tell you that when mommy went into labor, I panicked and immediately ordered myself a Papa John's pizza. And when the doorbell rang, she assumed it was the cab taking us to the hospital. It wasn't. It was a guy delivering a pie. One day, we'll watch Frozen. And then the day after that, we'll probably watch it again. And one day, we'll stop watching Frozen, and then we'll watch Frozen 2. One day, we'll go to the beach. I'll catch a crab if they're not extinct by then. One day, we'll listen to music in the car, and I'll try to explain what UK garage was. One day, you won't need me to get dressed, to get you dressed. One day, I might need you to dress me. One day, you'll figure out that your uncle is actually my brother, and it'll blow your tiny mind. One day, you'll be able to hold my hand instead of me just holding yours. One day, you'll want to go camping. That'll be a firm no for me. But maybe you can join the scouts or something and go with them. One day you'll draw me a picture, and I'll keep it on the fridge under a magnet that me and your mom bought when we went to Spain. One day I'll ask you about school and who your mates are and what subjects you like. One day we'll go on a plane, and you won't be scared, because why would you be? One day you'll have an Instagram or TikTok or a microchip in your brain or whatever they're doing those days. One day I'll show you pictures and videos to try to prove I had a life before I was your dad. I'll say I had long hair and went to a party with famous people, and you won't believe me. One day you'll be too big for your clothes or your bed or for cuddles. One day you'll love someone more than me. One day I won't see you every day. One day you'll be 18, and I'll wonder how that happened and why I didn't spend more time with you. One day you'll be angry with me. You'll realize all the ways I'm imperfect and which I messed up, and all I can say is I'm already sorry, and then I always tried to do my best. One day we'll argue because I'm old now, and I don't understand the world because you think people should be allowed to marry their phone, and I don't agree. One day I won't be here. And one day I'll wonder at how I knew all this after just one day. But for now, that one day is more than enough. It's like perfume, right? It's beautiful. And none of it's real. I mean, I have no idea if any of that will ever happen in the life of this guy. No idea what will take place with his son or anything. It's like perfume. His son, his newborn child, as he's holding him, is emitting promise. And he's writing about promise and hope. But the difference is when it comes to the day of your death and we eulogize you, we stand up in front and we start writing poetry about who you were. That's substance. That's the real you. That wasn't just some emitted, like, this is what I want the world to think of me. It's actually what the world thought of you. Because you lived all those days and you showed everybody that that's actually the case. And that is better. That kind of beauty, that's better. So the day of your death says way more than the day of your birth. It's better then to go to the house of mourning, right? This is just to a funeral, than to go to the house of feasting, to a party, right? That's what everybody's like. Okay, so I got a phone call today from a friend, and he said that he wanted me to attend a funeral with him, and it's his brother. And then at the same time, I got a phone call from another friend, and he said that he wanted me to come to a party where they'd be watching the Super Bowl. So it was a choice between, like, disgusting, happy snacks and death. And everyone chose death. Right? Although, and I mean, to be honest with you, watching the 49ers in a Super Bowl is worse than death, from my point of view, but I'm a Seahawks fan. Anyway, look, here. They won once. They did. A lot more recently than the Packers and Bears. It's better to go to the house in the morning than to go to the house of feasting. No, it's not. We would never make that choice. Not once in our life would we make that choice. Why? Why would you make that choice? Well, for this is the end of all mankind. What is? The house of mourning is. When you're sitting in the funeral that you chose to go to instead of watching the Super Bowl, you are not being distracted from the reality, the stark truth that every single person who has breath in their lungs will not one day soon. The Super Bowl will distract you from that. You will not think about that once while you're eating the food. Well, you might, I mean, when you're eating the Dorito, you might like, this might kill me. But that's the fleeting, this is a fleeting thought. It will just go away. But when you're sitting there listening to somebody talk about this life of this person and seeing the wreath in front and their picture up there and maybe the casket, you cannot dodge it. You have to focus on the fact that I will someday be there. The living, he says, when they are in the house of mourning, recognizing that it's the end of all mankind, the living will lay it to heart. That's what you do at a funeral, he's saying, is that you'll lay it to heart, and that's a good thing. That you lay it to heart. Can I be honest with you? We don't lay it to heart. If there is one thing that I can say without apology in the Western world is that we do not like to talk about death. We just, I'll be honest with you, this might be the only sermon in your life that you hear that's just about death. We don't like talking about it. Let me give you my personal experience with death. I did not see a dead body for my entire childhood. My grandfather died when I was 12, but my parents told me, just stay at home for the funeral. I don't remember, we never went to the funeral. Just stay at home. It was a long way away. I was living in Seattle. They were way out in Boston. So my parents said, just stay here. They went to Boston, and I think that they had kind of an open casket. That was sort of the thing for a while. Nowadays, they don't do that as much. You know, I the other day I was asking somebody, they said, well, we're having a viewing. I didn't know what that was. We're having a viewing. And the reason I don't know what that was is because most of the places I've been in my life, they don't do that. They don't have a moment where everybody walks by the casket and sees the body of this individual sitting there. The only time in my life where I made, the first time and only time that I've ever been into a funeral with an open casket was when I was a youth pastor in a farming community, and my father-in-law, who is the pastor of the church, came and said to me, look, I need you to be an usher for the funeral. So I stood at the door. That was my job, right? Wear my best clothes, which was like sweats and a long sleeve. No, I stood at the door, and they wheeled in this casket, and the top was open, and there was a woman's body in there, and she was white as a sheet, and I had never seen anything like it. I totally froze. It's been imprinted in my head. I could draw it for you if you want. It's the closest I'd ever been to a dead body. I knew people died. I'd just never seen anybody who had died. A little bit later, we lived, when I was there, in this farming community, we lived above a morgue. I think I've said that before. If you didn't know that, everyone should live above a morgue sometime in their life because it is quite an experience, right? Like 2 a.m, all of a sudden the garage door goes open and you're like, what's that? Oh, yeah. But when I used to have to pay the rent, I'd have to go downstairs, and Walt was the funeral director or the mortician, and he owned the building. We'd go downstairs and have to pay the rent with a check. And so sometimes Walt was not in his office, because that's not the only thing morticians do. I didn't think about that. But when I went downstairs on one occasion, I knocked on the door of the office. He wasn't there, and so I started wandering around because I had this check in my hand. I didn't know what to do with it. I was like, it was the last day of the month. I wanted to make sure he got it. I ended up walking down, and there were folding, like an accordion door, right? And it had not totally shut, and I heard somebody in there. And so I just walked in with my check, and there is Walt painting the face and body of a naked man who was whiter than the lady in the casket. And Walt turned to me. He smells, listen, our house always smelled like formaldehyde all the time. He turned to me and went, oh, you shouldn't be in here. And I'm honestly, he had to come over and pull me out because I was like, makeup on this man's face to make it look like he was alive. Because look, we want the corpse to look more alive, right? It's kind of a game we play a little bit. I mean, listen, I prefer it. But we kind of want to make it look like, well, they're not bloodless dead. Still got a little bit of life in their faces. My mother died November 11th, 2011. And I remember that afternoon being called into the hospital after being away for just a few hours to have a shower. And she had died when I left. So I went back and I walked into the room and I leaned over and they had brushed her hair back so that we wetted it and brushed it straight back. And I leaned over and I kissed her forehead, and it was the first time in my life I had kissed my mother's forehead and felt it as cold as room temperature, cooler than that. I didn't know what to do with it. I still feel it on my lips. You stare at that dead body for a little bit, and you're like, oh my, oh my. And you turn away. I don't want to look at it. I don't want to spend time thinking about it. Most people I know, when COVID started and they started putting the numbers on TV, were like, that's a lot of people dying. And then people who were critical of it were saying, guys, people die, this many people die every year. So if you were reading, people would say, oh yeah, that many people died from COVID? Well, look what heart disease does. We should have a running counter for heart disease. And I was like, what? That many people die from heart disease? Yeah. But every time you sat and watched TV in Canada, numbers on the corner. You know, it used to be the case that when you came to a church, they always put their graveyards next to the church. Lots of reasons for that, but I'm sure one of them was that every time you came to the church, you had to walk through the dead people. You walked through them when you went in, you walked through them when you went out, and what a message that tells you. Someday, sooner than you think, you and I will die. And we want to avoid it as much as we possibly can. We like our churches far from the graveyard, though. We like our caskets closed. We like our corpses alive. We like our kids at home for funerals. We shield our eyes from death. And Kohelet's argument in this little passage is essentially that is all to our detriment. You are losing something fundamental that you gain if you stare death in the face and do not look away. If you realize that maybe for the first time in your life that this life is ending and you dwell on it for a minute, instead of trying to find some distraction to get you away from it. It's the end of all mankind, and the living will lay it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter. Why? How in the world can you say that? Sorrow is better than laughter? Well, for by sadness of face, the heart is made glad. This word heart, this means about the core of your being. The deep down inside, you will be made glad more by sorrow than you would by laughter. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, right? It's in the funeral, but the heart of the fools is in the house of mirth. It's just hanging out with the partiers all the time. You are a fool if you just choose that all the time, as opposed to dwelling on death, which of course raises the next another question. Like, wait, help me understand exactly what you're trying to get at. And so I came up with a little image that might be helpful, it might not. Here's what I think he's trying to say. So we have a laundry room, and occasionally our laundry room smells to high heaven. I don't know why, but there are moments where you walk in and you're like, whoo. Now, admittedly, our dog is in there often, and dogs sometimes do things that make it smell, but what you do is you look around to see if that's happened, and it's not happened, but it still stinks. But you and I know that sometimes, you know, an old rag or something gets thrown toward the washing machine, and it goes to the other side where all the socks are, and it goes down there, and then it gets rotten. Starts to stink, like, you know, my kid's shoes after baseball. And you walk in the room, and it's disgusting. Now here's my approach to that. Have you guys heard of this thing called Febreze? Yeah, it's good stuff. I'm just going to tell you. Here's my approach to it. Spray it, right? Just spray it over it. And here's why it's my approach. It's immediately satisfactory. But I don't have to do any. I don't have to search. I don't have to go through the hard work of looking for the stupid smelly rag. I don't have to do it. I can cover it up with the Febreze. I don't know if you've ever done this before, though, that Febreze, it just doesn't work. It doesn't last very long. And I actually think it adds a special kind of awful to the smell afterwards. And you would say, well, the better thing for you to do, of course, Jeff, is for you to take the time, whether it's hard or not, to go look for that rag, to find the source of it, and to pull it out. See, your heart, Jeff, will be made glad by the harder, deeper work of finding the source of the trouble and pulling it out than by just constantly covering it over so that you can it can be distracted from for a very brief short of time, period of time. I think that's what he's saying here, is that, look, the reason that sorrow is better than laughter is that laughter's fine, but it's Febreze. It's a distraction, and it sprays over the top of the reality that death stinks. And it's always waiting for you. You can try to fix it with whatever activity you want by saying, well, I'm going to watch more movies, or I'm going to focus more on the sports, or I'm going to get into dance, or I don't care. Read a book, play a video game. I want to be distracted from it, right? But even after the distraction, it's still there. And it'll start to smell again. And you can keep trying to distract yourself, but the cliff is there. It will come in time. It's better to do longer reflection and deal with it truly than to just Febreze it over and over. And so his argument is, man, you guys, think about death. All right. So, okay, we buy your argument. I can see what you're trying to say, Kohelet. Fine. There's a value in thinking about death. But what are the outcomes then? Let's think this through. I got three of them. There are more, but I've got three that came to mind immediately that I think are in line with what Kohelet's trying to say here in the rest of the book. Number one, I think death reorders our priorities. That shouldn't take a lot of convincing for you. You've faced death before or gotten close to it. Everybody has. You've driven a car in Chicago, you have. Like, I promise. I remember one of the closest to fatal car accidents I've ever had was when I was dating my girlfriend, now my wife, and I came down to the end of the street where she was living. She was in the passenger seat. I was in the driver's seat, and it was icy. And it's nearby where you live. You come out to the exit, and you're not thinking because there's no one there ever. And I came onto this road, and I pulled to the right. And as soon as I pulled out, and I had gone wide, right, because nobody's ever coming the other way. I went wide to the right, and as soon as I turned, I was facing a Subaru head on. And I don't know how this guy stopped his car, but he hit the brakes, and the back end of his car swerved like this. I kept going. He went back around, and he swerved around us just as I swerved this way, so that we were kind of parallel to each other at the end, and he was looking out of his window to me, and I was looking out of my window to him, and we sort of looked at each other for a second, like, oh my word, that was death. We just ducked it. Thank God, he was a Subaru driver, so he didn't get mad, because peace on earth and all that, you know. So I rode down the road, but heart racing. Remember, I had to pull over to the side for a few minutes just to stop. The rest of that day, I remember thinking about death. I just remember thinking to myself, I mean, I at the time was like 18, 19, 19 years old, and I was thinking, you know, when you're 19, life is filled with possibility and joy and excitement. And now all day long, I'm faced with thinking about death. And what it did to me, quite honestly, is it made me start to smell the roses. You know that. That's what happens. You start thinking, are the things that I'm living for the things that I want to be living for? 90s movie, You've Got Mail. They're in an elevator. Tom Hanks is in the movie. He's dating this woman who is awful. We're waiting for him to date Meg Ryan, who's wonderful. But the way that he ends up breaking up with his first girlfriend is they get stuck in an elevator with a group of other people, and they're sitting there in the elevator, and they start talking about how this might be where they die. And they start reflecting on, well, if this is my last day in here, if I ever get out of here, one of the guys says, I'm going to go ask so-and-so to marry me. I've been putting it off for a long time. I don't know what I'm doing. Why am I wasting time? This could be my last day. The others start talking about how they're going to call their parents, how they're going to do a particular thing. And, of course, Tom Hanks' girlfriend is complaining about where the breath mints are. And he realizes, this is not the person I want to be with. I don't want to be with somebody who's living their life for such stupid things. But what highlighted it? And the answer is staring a death did. It changed the way they viewed things. Now, the Bible says this, Psalm 90, verse 12. So teach us, Lord, to number our days that we may get a heart of wisdom. That you'll start thinking about the important things. I met two men in 1 week here at Harvest a couple of weeks ago. Two men in 1 week both had a blood disease that they know is killing them. And so when I meet people like that, I usually try to engage in some conversation about it. I'm one of these guys who's like, if there's an elephant in the room, I'm like, did you guys see the elephant? It's over here. And I really wanted to know. I asked both of them, Christian men, I asked both of them, how has this disease influenced the way that you think about things? You know, because we're always told this, right? You don't want to be on your deathbed looking back and saying, I wish I would have, I wish I would have, I wish I would have. Well, here's a couple of guys who are like pretty close to their deathbed. What are you thinking about? And both of the men said basically the same thing, which was, I would never wish to have this kind of blood disease. And yet now that I have it, it has brought me more clarity, love for God, joy with my spouse, happiness in the world as I walk through it than anything else has in my life. And so as much as I hate it, I would never want to go without it. It's a clarifying thing, death. What will you be happy what you did? When you're on your deathbed and you know that those are the last moments, what will you look back and think you were happy to do? Well, you start saying to yourself, I wish I did spend more time at the office. But will you look back and think, man, that game that I freaked out about in the eighth inning was really important? The 49ers making the Super Bowl was worth getting upset over. Guys, there's so many things that you and I think about and prioritize and consider on a daily basis that really have little place for occupying our worries. They should not take a preeminence in our hearts and minds like they do. They should not. They're not things that really matter in the end. Yet we place our hope and our joy and everything in them and thinking, oh, this moment can come through for me. And when you're laying there on your deathbed, I promise if I have a video and I show it to you, so remember how excited you were about this particular thing and incensed and angry? They said this about me. How do you feel now? Reorients our priorities. Second, I think death forces us to see our real place in the world. What is that? Small. Psalm 103, 15. As for man, his days are like grass. He flourishes like a flower of the field, for the wind passes over it, and it's gone, and its place it knows no more. It's a very brief thing. The flower of the field comes up. It's there for a short season, and it dries out almost sometimes as quick as it came up. Actually, the hot wind comes. There's not a lot of water around. It just goes away. Oh, Lord, what is man? This is Psalm 144. Oh, Lord, what is man that you regard him, or the son of man that you think of him? Man is he's like a breath. His days are like a passing shadow. Guys, in the cold morning, and it's gone. James says your life is but a mist. You appear for a little while and then you vanish. But we get obsessed with how important we are and our lives are to the operation of the world or to the company or to this aspect of whatever. 2020, I was watching the Academy, last time I watched the Academy Awards, 2020. I used to watch them all the time. But the last time I watched them, I tuned in right at the point that they do the in memoriam. Do you guys know, remember in Academy Awards, they show this video of all the people in art and the performing arts who had died in the last year, people part of the film industry. I'm gonna give you a list of the people they put on the screen. 2020, the in memoriam part of Academy Awards were Kobe Bryant, Michael Douglas, James Lipton inside the actor's studio, Kenny Rogers, the gambler, Roy Horn, who is the Roy version part of Siegfried and Roy, Little Richard, Jerry Stiller, who is George Seinfeld's dad in Seinfeld, and Ben Stiller's real dad. Charlie Daniels, country music star. Regis Philbin. Wilford Brimley, it's a good thing. Chadwick Boseman, Black Panther. Eddie Van Halen. Sean Connery. And Alex Trebek. The most important people in the world die. The people who claim, like John Lennon, that I'm going to be more important than Jesus, die. Everybody dies. And the fact that when we think about that, here's what happens. Humility replaces hubris. Our arrogance tends to float away. And what kind of arrogance? Our ability to control everything and our desire to control everything. You're going to die. You have no control over it. It will come and it will take you. And you don't have any control over it. And that should start you thinking, what things do I have control over in my life? Guys, seriously, you spend 1/3 of every single day totally oblivious to the world around you. You're snoring away in there, and the world goes on without you. We are not in control, quite honestly, of much at all. But the fact that we want to be in control is basically killing us. We want to place those burdens on our shoulders and say, but I have to be in control of these things, and I have to know the answers about things, and So we pick them up and we throw them on our shoulders and we're carrying them around and we're dying under the weight of something you cannot carry because you weren't made to do it. You're going to die. You have limits. We moved from Vancouver, British Columbia, where the water coming out of the taps is wonderful. You can stick your face under there and drink it like crazy. We came to Chicago area, where if you do that, you will get lead poisoning or some kind of thing. So we ended up getting like delivery bottles. We thought, well, okay, we're going to save because we're, you know, from that part of the Pacific Northwest. And so we're like, we're going to save the earth through recycling or not using plastic. And so we were like, this is going to be less than plastic water bottles and stuff. And so we got the big water cooler things and they deliver them, I put them inside the front door. When we first got there, like the first couple deliveries, my daughter, Sophie, she tried to pick up one of these water bottles and she had it, it's like 50 pounds, but she's had it with two hands and now she's gotta go up like six steps and across the floor to try to drag it to where the machine is. And she starts on the first step and she's dying. And I said, honey, just leave it there. That's too big for you. Don't you ever think to yourself that maybe God is just trying to remind you through the sleep every day and the fact that if you looked at death, you'd say, I have limitations. And he'd be like, man, why don't you just leave some of that stuff there? You know, all the stuff you're picking up and saying, well, I'm worried about this because I got to make the changes so that the world goes. The Lord's like, that's a heavy water bottle, man. And you weren't meant to carry it. I have the ability, says the Lord, to carry those water bottles, but it's not for you. So why are you trying to pick them up all the time? Do you really have control over the way people think of you? Do you? Do you have any control at all over the opinions of others? Because that's really the one that I think of. There's five water bottles and four of them are, they think this of me. And I'm picking all of them up and carrying them. And I don't control that. I have limitations. I'm going to die. I don't have what's required to carry all of the weight of the world and the fact that there's injustice everywhere. I pray, Lord, your kingdom come, your will be done, but I don't have control ultimately over all of the sadness. I don't. But if I'm going to try to carry it constantly, it's just going to kill me. And sometimes it kills me. It's too big for you. You're not meant to carry that. All right, last one. Death also raises questions about what's next. Of course it does. The fact that we have an ending makes you wonder, all right, is it just off a cliff and into the abyss of nothingness? Like, what's happening? There's a movie that Justin Timberlake was in. I do not recommend it. It's kind of boring. But the movie's called In Time. I watched it a while ago. The movie is, basically, the story is everybody, they figured out a way for everyone to be perpetually 25 years old. So you grow to 25, and then at 25 years old, you have 1 year to live. But you could get more time by working, by stealing the time from other people. You can get more time by doing that sort of thing all over the place. You can give some to your friend or whatever, but the secret is on your forearm. It's always telling you how much time you have left. Several points in the movie, he gets down to 30 seconds or 2 seconds, and I actually think this would be a great thing to have. For every single piece. It's basically, if Kohelet could do it, he's like, do that. Put it on your arm so that you realize every single moment of your life that you don't have that much time left. If you look straight in the eye of death repeatedly, you will end up asking the most important question. What's that? It is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment. So if you want to know what the Bible has to teach about afterlife, judgment. That you will stand before the living God and you will give an account. Sinclair Ferguson, great pastor, Scottish pastor, he said, behind everyone we meet stands the shadow of judgment. They themselves do not see it. They may have spent all their lives denying it or hiding from it, but one day the account will be presented. The verdict will be passed and the judgment given. And staring at death helps you realize that and raises then the question, are you prepared for it? So a last 90s film reference is from 1989, but who cares? Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. There's a scene in this movie where Indy's driving a boat away from the guys who are trying to protect the chalice, the cup of Christ from being found. By the way, if I just gave out the ending to you, I'm sorry, it's 80-something, okay? You should have seen it already. There's a scene where he's driving the boat, you know, Indiana Jones, the other guy, he's jumping into the other boat, beating everyone up, and then that guy's jumping into his boat, and finally, they end in a place where there's the propeller of a massive ship, and it's cutting through this wood boat slowly as they fight and fight and fight further and further back on the ship. And then they get into this sort of like headlocks with each other. And Indy says to this guy, if you don't give in, we're both gonna die. And the guy looks at him and says, my soul's prepared. How's yours? So the cliff is coming. I don't know when it could come after church today for you. No guarantee. There's a lot of people in the world who've left a church meeting and died by getting hit by a train. It could be a long way off, but the cliff's still there. Right? The propeller is chopping away at your life, and the bits and pieces of that boat are going further and further. So now that I've got you in a good headlock, I got to tell you, my soul's prepared. How's yours? The only people who can treat death as a pet are the ones for whom the sting no longer remains. And the only way for the sting not to remain is to believe in the one who defeated it, the Lord Jesus Christ. And listen to me, all that's required for you to follow Jesus and receive eternal life is to say openly, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. I want to follow you the rest of my days here on earth so I can spend the rest of eternity with you. Don't delay. Don't delay. Let me pray for us. Father, I'm thankful that death is defeated. And when it is, the knowledge of it becomes actually helpful. I do pray, Lord, that there are people in this room. You know, every time I speak to groups, Father, you know that there are people that you bring who are in the room who do not know you, who are living their lives filled with distractions. They are not asked or called by our society to think about death. They're told to put it off and pretend it's not happening. And therefore, they miss out on the benefit of thinking about what's next. And so I pray, Father, that Spirit, you would come and that you would fill the minds and hearts of the people here, and that, Jesus, you would be asking that question of people. Are you prepared? Are you prepared? And if there are those, Father, who do not believe that, yet have not committed their lives to Christ, I pray, Lord, that you, by your Spirit, would convict them and move them to let go. They're not in control. To let go, to give up to you. So grant us salvation, we pray. Grant us a memory of salvation, we pray. If we've already been saved, help us to rejoice in the fact that we will never be stung by death. Face it, we will, but never be stung by it. And I pray, Father, that you would grant so many this weekend and through our church and all the other churches in our region and all the other people who are proclaiming the gospel all over the world this weekend in churches and other places. I pray that this would be a great weekend of fruit as the Spirit draws in his people. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us? Yeah.
Aren't you thankful for God's word? Sometimes you lean into it and you find it's leaning into you. And maybe today's a day like that for you. If you find yourself in a place where you've got that heavy burden, it's too much for me, can't carry that, I hope you'll come forward. We'd love to pray for you with some of our leaders. And if you're not clear that my soul is ready to see the Lord, to be with the Lord, we would absolutely love to talk to you about that today, because there is hope and forgiveness and life in Jesus. If you're new, come say hi. I'm going to go out to the welcome area. We'd love to meet you. But as we go out now on mission for Jesus Christ, know you are loved.